So happy to be here. Thank you to the organizer for inviting the European Research Council representative, that is me today, to disseminate the good practices to write a successful ERC proposal. So maybe I have to find, yeah? I'm also happy to be in a very good company here. Don't feel alone. So, I guess most of you knows what the ERC is, but just a few words. The ERC is the European Research Council, is an independent body funding outstanding research, blue sky research, that is ruled by a scientific body. Of the 22 experts dealing with all the scientific disciplines, and it funds research, bottom-up research in every discipline. There is no predefined subject, and the excellence is the only criterion that is taken into account for the final decision for funding. We are now in the last year of the research framework. As you can see, we are now opening the call for 2020, actually in less than 2 weeks. And there are 2.2 billion euros devoted to funding outstanding research, let's say, from most of them from young people and also for senior researchers. So as you can see here, the large majority of the ERC funding goes to young researchers. There are more than 50,000 let's say early and mid-career researchers funded so far, and as I said, 2/3 of the grants have gone to early stage researcher. What the ERC offers is independence, scientific independence, recognition and visibility. You can work on your own idea with the team that you choose by yourself, and you have the financial autonomy for 5 years. You can negotiate with the host institution the best condition, otherwise the grant is portable, so you can move to another host institution where you find better condition for you. You can attract the member that you decide are the right one to work with you. And it is a sign, actually, that the agency identified that to have an ERC grant is actually a sign of scientific quality label, let's say, that enable the scientist to attract further funding and to gain international recognition. So, what are the tools that we use for funding scientists? There are three main funding schemes. They are so-called the individual grant scheme, dedicated to young researcher. Let's say those that are from 2 to 7 years after the PhD. Then to the mid-career researcher, that are those from 7 to 12 years after the PhD, and then the advanced grant for people that have already an established career. And then the recent one is the synergy grant, that is the possibility that give the possibility to found a small network of scientists from 2 to 4, and and in this case, the grant is commensurate to the research. The grant itself goes from 1.5 million euros for the starting grant to 2 million euros for the consolidator grant, 2.5 million euros, and 10 million euros for the collaborative grant. All of these grant has some restriction, rules that applies. This means that if you succeed, that's fine, you get the grant. But if you do not succeed, and it depends which grade you got, you may not be able to apply to the very next call. As it has been demonstrated that this is quite a strong, let's say, prohibition for the synergy grant that hamper the possibility of young scientists to apply to the individual call. With this work program, the new work program just publicly available, the restriction rules for resubmission of the synergy grant have been relaxed. What does it mean? That if a young scientist, okay, so someone eligible for the starting or the consolidator grant, apply for a synergy proposal and the proposal fail to succeed, they can apply to any of the individual calls. Okay? So this applies only for young scientists. The resubmission rules remains for the advanced grant. So for those that are in that that want to apply to this goal. So who can apply? Anyone, any nationality, any age, any working wherever the scientist is at the moment. The only requirement is to have a support letter from an host institution that has to be located in Europe or in an associated country. So, what is evaluated? When you submit your proposal, it will be evaluated only on the excellence criterion. The excellence of the proposal, of the idea, so the groundbreaking nature of your idea, the potential impact in the scientific field of your idea, and the scientific approach, and then the excellence of the principal investigator on their intellectual capacity, on their creativity, and on their commitment to the project. So I don't want to go now in details, maybe I leave it after for the question, but the important point to for submitting the proposal is that the proposal is made of two parts. Part B1, that is a 5-page of extended synopsis of the research project, and 2 pages of the CV of the applicant. And then there is the second part of the project that is 15 pages, that is the full scientific proposal. So the evaluation is made in two steps. The first step, the expert, the panel of scientists read only the part B1. This means the extended synopsis and your CV. And if the proposal is found good enough to be further evaluated, it passed to step 2, where a panel of expert plus specialists in the field will also evaluate the scientific proposal, the full scientific proposal. So they will go to assess the 15 page of the project. Here you see all the scientific domain that at which you can actually apply. And of course there are the life sciences, the social sciences and humanities, and the physical science and engineering. And being here with a lot of chemists, at least the majority I guess, let's say that I point out that the two panels that are the chemistry panel, PE4, physical and analytical chemical science, and PE5, synthetic chemistry and materials. So, how do you prepare and submit a successful ERC proposal? You must have an idea that is bright, original, and exciting. You have to design your research project, implementing the idea, of course, get a commitment letter from the host institution, so an institution that will host you if you succeed to get the grant. And also consider who is going to review your proposal. And here I'm talking specifically of the ERC. Be aware that at step one, there are the experts are requested to review the proposal, to evaluate the proposal from a generalistic perspective. So you have people that are expert. Of course, if it is a chemistry proposal, you will have a chemistry. You will not have a philosopher reviewing your proposal. That's true, but the expert might not be really in your exact field. So the synopsis, the part B1, must be written in a way that is clear enough and transfer the novelty even to people that are not true expert in your specific field. While the part B2, the full proposal, then has to be detailed enough, because at the step two you will have a specialist reading it. Then you have, of course, to submit the research proposal before the deadline. Okay, it might seem, trivial, but it is not, I can assure you. We still have cases that it happens that something went wrong at the last moment. And so, please submit well in advance, because you can, at any moment before the deadline, to revise and say what you have done. And then, if you are successful at step two, you will receive an invitation letter for an interview. If you are applying to a starting grant or a consolidator grant. And here, what we suggest strongly is to rehearse. To rehearse because it is a really scientific discussion when you have the time and the opportunity to discuss with people that evaluate your proposal, and you have the possibility to make your case with your idea. So, another important point that I want to say is that you might not be successful at the first time, but from data we have, we strongly suggest to keep trying, because reapplication, it is demonstrated that reapplication has a much higher success rate, and we have been told by reapplicants that they were finally successful, that the feedback they got through the evaluation report really helped them to build up a much better project. So, what you have to ask when you have your idea and you write your project? If your idea is new and it is beyond the state of the art, if you have the right expertise to pursue the research, and if you need collaborators, and which kind of collaboration, and which are their role, and what are the resources that are needed? Because you are looking for 1.5 or 2 million euros, okay? So you must clearly prepare also the budget for your project. And then, especially, this is if the project is feasible. And this is particularly important because the feasibility of the project is evaluated at step one. Get the letter, another important point is get the letter from the host institution. So the sooner the better is that you get in contact with the host institution research office in order to check that they are available to host you. And also, if you can get in contact with the national contact point that usually have people dedicated to the ERC grant. for information how to get the host institution appointment letter. Important is that the grant is portable, as I said. You can change the host institution during the project life if the host institution does not ensure you the scientific independence and all you need to pursue the research. So there are rumors, we know, that claims that the quality or the fame of the host institution increased the chance and the scores, so makes your proposal more appealing to the expert. This is not true, because the host institution is not an evaluation criteria. The evaluation criteria is the project and is the scientific profile of the applicant. And again, there is rumors that there are lobbying to introduce quota. This is also not true, because lobbying is firmly rejected. And this is a task for which the scientific officer take care not to, that this not, does not appear during the evaluation. Then also you have to think to make you visible, because the expert, of course, judge your profile, the scientific profile, from what you have given, but they might also expand their research in the web. So make your profile accessible in the web, let's say with your own web page or with your own profile described in the group website, and maybe also, like, because we have this possibility in our scientific domain, get an ORCID ID so that someone looking for it can go and find what you state in your two-page CV, and put it the link, let's say it's better to put the link or ID identification number in the proposal, so they don't, expert don't have to struggle to find you in the web. And work, this is also important, work on your publication record. The important point is to have some paper, one at least for the beginners, without the PhD supervisor. Okay? This is very important, because it shows your scientific independence. And this is the important, an important feature of an applicant for any, of not say for a grant, an ESC grantee, because the expert, the evaluators must be reassured that the grantee has the capacity to lead independently the research and to manage the budget. So when you write your research proposal, please read carefully the guide for applicants before writing it, and start early. And start early and get used to the web system for introducing the research in the ERC, in the participant portal, and also get feedback from your peers, or get feedback from senior scientists, get feedback from people maybe that are very close to your, that are working in the same field as you are, but also from people that are a bit far, because they, you know, they play the role of the generalist. So if they understand the novelty, if they understand the project, it means you are writing your proposal in the right direction. So here you have some link that you can use to get more information, and here there is a list, but if you just search for ERC, then therein, navigating therein, you can find all these things. The important point is get prepared for to write means to have an idea what is the success rate, for example. it is much higher than other funding scheme. We are now around 11%. One proposal out of 10 application is funded. So this is not bad. And look at who are the experts that are evaluating your proposal. So every 2 years, the panel changes. And the panel is renewed by at least 1/3. So if you look at who they probably are, you get an idea of the level of people that are evaluating your proposal. Okay? And so you prepare it accordingly. Then, if you want to apply, make all the best you can to do a very good, not a very good, an excellent proposal. Do not try, because there are submission rules. So this means that if you fail, you might not be able to apply to the next school. And be convinced that your idea is good. But also not only be convinced only by yourself. Like, share the idea with others that are able to understand and to give you advice, even if it is really new or if it is something that is incremental, because the ERC does not fund incremental research. So if you are not convinced, so wait and apply to the next call. This means you can wait not only because of the idea, but maybe you want strengthen your profile. This means publishing more or doing some other activity that increase your scientific profile. And also be aware that you are eligible, you have to check if you are eligible and for which call, but there are also extensions of eligibility that are possible. And you have the case paternity leave for mothers of 18 months per child, paternity leave according to the time, and then others that are well described in the work program and also in the guide for applicant. So, here another point is when you prepare your project, you have to make a real careful identification of the panel to which you apply, because you cannot choose the panel strategically. There is no possibility that you apply to one panel because they are said it's easier to get funded, because you are killing in this way your proposal. You have to look at the panel, you have to look at the descriptors, and that in chemistry, for the chemistry panel, here there are something, so you indicate the right panel, you indicate the right descriptors, and once it's done, be aware that your proposal is allocated to the expert according to the panel descriptor and the panel and the panel you have chosen. Regarding interdisciplinary proposal, you can even mention a secondary panel, but if you do, then be sure that it is the case that it is an interdisciplinary proposal, because it is not true that the more panel you mention, the more possibility you have to be funded, because especially at step one, there are generalists that read your proposal, and if they do not understand it, then your proposal fails. Writing a part B1, be sure not to oversell yourself or your idea, avoid jargon, because of course again we are talking about generalist, and pay a lot of attention how you write and avoid any defects, let's say, because it's the first impression that of your project and of yourself. Even typos are not nice to see in this proposal. And they, at step one, they check the feasibility. So make clear the point that your project is feasible. What is important also to see is the idea that has to be innovative. Important is that you indicate how much it goes beyond the state of the art. This means that you know perfectly the state of the art. Please do not overlook at it, because it is extremely important. And then, is it your proposal timely? Why it was not done in the past? Again, go back to the state of the art and check why it was not tried. So to show your the novelty of your proposal, and what is the risk of your proposal, and how you will deal with it. This is important. Then again, give a description of yourself and why you are the right person to do it. If you are able, you are to show it that you are able to work independently and to manage the budgets for 5 years. Show that you are internationally competitive and that you are able to be a leader in your field. There are also, you know, rumors saying that it is important to have published in outstanding journal like Nature and Science. Well, actually, it's not really true. If you publish in this kind of journal, apart exception, this means that you have worked with senior scientists, and this may put, you know, in doubt your scientific independence. So the important is to publish. And then, also important is some citation that you have, so showing that someone read the research that you do. For the part B2, so the full proposal, do not repeat the synopsis, because who is reading part B2 will have already read part B1. So if you repeat it, this is not nice. Explain your hypothesis and provide preliminary data if they exist. If they don't exist, then no problem. Show that your hypothesis is grounded on the state of the art, and show why you are behind the state of the art. Provide strategies to mitigate the risk. And let's say there should be a clear link. The part B2 should be should describe fully in detail the part B1. It should not be, you know, completely different. And sometimes this also happens. So, what can I say more in detail, because I don't want to steal time to others. Important point is what I am already doing, I know. But I want to tell you so many things that important point is that it must be really easy to read. You must give full references, because this does not count toward the pages. And explain properly the budget, because if your budget is not well explained, then it will be cut. This is for sure. You have to explain each and every cost that you want. And be aware of open access. You can ask funding for open access, because this is the policy of the EU funding. Why proposals are rejected at the ERC? Because the scope is too narrow or too broad, and so the proposal is unfocused, because they are incremental research, or because there is so the project is more loose collaboration rather than, you know, the idea of one PI. The work plan is not detailed enough, is not clear, and there is no management of the risk, or again because the principal investigator does not have a sufficient track record, or it doesn't show enough scientific independence. So, as I said, if you don't succeed at the first step, try again, but be aware that you cannot apply again in the very next year, depending on which stage you are rejected. And we go in detail maybe afterward with the question. And for the interview, You will, if you succeed at step one, you will be invited for the interview. You have 2 months in advance. You are invited 2 months in advance. Typically, there is a 10 minutes presentation and then 10-15 minutes of interview. And it is actually a scientific discussion. The expert want to know more about your project. The schedule is very tight, so rehearsing in order to stay on time. Don't oversell it because you are talking to scientists, so you are not talking to a general audience trying to sell an idea. They are expert, and it's normal to be nervous, but they just want to know more about your project. And be prepared to defend your budget. If you do not want to apply now, if you want to know more, there is also possibility from people going, from people coming from outside Europe or from people in Europe to visit and to participate to an ERC research project. And again, in the website, you find a way to join an ERC team and to see how it works from inside. Here are the deadlines for the next call. So in less than 2 weeks, the starting grant will open for the very young scientist. And the deadline for submission is the 16th of October. And it is expected to fund a bit less than 700 proposals. So are you ready? I'm ready for, and sorry to keep it so long.